So a quick example of flow control inside of a function. So I've created a new function here, call it flow function, flow func, and I am using a variable number of arguments by using these ellipses or splat. And what I'm going to do is say print, I can tell you how many arguments you passed. I'm going to use this inbuilt Julia function length again, which is just going to count the number of arguments that are passed. And then remember, this is a new line character. And I'm going to have this variable called I, and I'm going to set it I equals 1. And it doesn't exist outside of my function, because remember, it's here, it's inside of a function. And now I have a for loop inside of a function. So I'm going to iterate over all the arguments that I pass by using this for n in arguments. Then I'm going to print a line argument. And then I, remember, I is 1 at the moment. And we pass a tab, n, and remember that is going to go through these arguments one by one. And then a new line. And then we're going to increment I by 1. So I equals I plus 1, or shorthand I plus equals 1. Then we're going to end our for loop, and then we're going to end our function. So you see there's a little bit of a problem here with the indentation. Didn't indent quite properly in iJulia. It doesn't matter. It will still work. So let's run that function. Let's create that function. And now let's call it. And I'm going to pass all of these arguments again. Julia is 1 in a million. Two of them are values. The rest are strings. And look what it's done. So it says I can tell you how many arguments you've passed. There were 7. And then it's going to run through the for loop. So it's going to print argument, then I, remember I was 1, and because it is looping through this n, so the first time it goes through it'll be 1, so the first argument was Julia. Now we increment I by 1, so the next time we run through, I is now 2, so it's going to print argument 2 to the screen, n is now incremented to 2, so that'll be the second argument that I passed, and so on. So, quite nice. Now though, let's pass some arrays as function arguments. So we've created these functions, we've created these arguments, we've even created keyword arguments, we've created used the splat to create an infinite number, possible infinite number of arguments. But what if I wanted to not pass a single value, but I wanted to pass a whole array? So let's create an array or column vector here by the fact that I create this computer variable called xvals, and these square brackets indicate the fact that it is an array. So it looks like I'm going from negative 3 to 3 and I'm incrementing by a half. So that's an array of values. Let's create, there we are, negative 3 to 3. Now let's create a function, and I'm going to call my function sqr. And it's going to take a single argument called a, and it's going to return a squared, and then end. So it's a generic function with a single method. Now let's map. Let's use the map function. That is one way to use a function, and then as an argument, instead of passing a single value, we pass a whole array. So it's map. Then I call my function, and I don't use parentheses and then pass an argument. I say comma, and then the xval. So I'm mapping the array to the function. And there we go. It's going to take every element, and it's going to square. So 3 becomes 9, negative 3 becomes 9, and negative 2.5 becomes 6.25, etc. Now, I've left this out, but you can certainly do getfly to plot this, and you'll see beautifully the x squared pattern that you will see. Now, let's just have a look at something. Map is not always the best thing to do. Some of the functions, at least in Julia, the inbuilt functions, they have their own inbuilt mapping. And I'm going to use this macro called atTime, which will tell me how much time it takes to execute this line of code, and how much memory was used. So remember, in some older text you will see this using this 1.10,000 with the square brackets. That's really been deprecated. We now use in Julia, we use the collect syntax. So I'm going to map the sine function, and I'm going to do the sine function for values from 1 to 10,000. So the sine of 1, sine of 2, sine of 3, sine of 4, sine of 5, sine of 6. I'm going to go through that 10,000 times. Let's see what happens. That took 0.03 seconds, and it used 1.29 megabytes of memory. Now let's time it again, but instead of mapping, I'm just going to use the inbuilt, so sine can map an array to it as part of its inbuilt ability. And look at the difference now. It only used 0.009 seconds and only 361 kilobytes. A lot less memory and a lot faster than using the map function. So map's not always ideal. We also have this problem when we use arrays. Now remember the arrays, the square brackets, tuples assist this list with these parentheses. If I have a function that takes two arguments and it returns 3 times x plus 2 times y, I cannot call that function h with an array or with a tuple. I'm going to get an error when I do that. Now, one way to get around it is the apply function, but that's been deprecated as well. We now rather use the splat or ellipses. So let's create our array 3 and 4 and our tuple 3 and 4. Let's have that. And now create our function h, which takes two arguments, 3 times x plus 2 times y. And instead of just passing that array or tuple as an argument, I use it as a splat. So h and array 1 splat and tuple 1 splat, and you can see what happens. It's going to pass 3 to the x and 4 to the y. So that would be one easy way of passing these arrays to a function. Now, except for numbers and characters or other plain data, values of arguments are passed by reference only and are not copied, as you can read there. They can therefore be altered. So let's have a look at this. I'm going to create this computer variable called array underscore primes. I'm going to pass it as an array by these square brackets, 1, 2, 3, 5, 7, 11, 13, 17, and 9. And we're going to have an argument as to whether 1 is a prime number or not. Certainly in Julia it's not, but we can have that argument elsewhere. So there's my array, a 9-element array in a single column. They're all 64-bit integers. So let's create this function called add underscore ELE, add element. And I've got a single argument there, A. And it's going to use the internal, the inbuilt Julia function push with this exclamation mark, which means add to the end. So it's going to take my argument and it's going to lob on 23 at the end. That's what the push exclamation mark, I'll use that term for now, push exclamation mark does. So let's run it and we pass to it the array of primes. So I'm again passing an array to, I'm passing an array to a function, and look what happened. The 23 was lobbed on at the back. And that's permanent because if I call array primes now, it's there. It is still there. Okay, so for now, we've just passed these normal arguments or keyword arguments or splat number of arguments. But we can be much more precise in what type of arguments we want to allow. We can control that, and we call that using type parameters or a parametric method. And that is up next.